Hi, I'm Ryo, and I tried winning Pokemon Platinum only using hot Pokemon. There's been a trend going around YouTube where people vote whether they would smash or pass each Pokemon. Since most of the smashable ones are agile but frail, I decided to see if the hottest of them all had what it takes to beat a Pokemon game all on their own. To make the game even harder, I also made this challenge a hardcore Nuzlocke. Aside from the standard rules like if a Pokemon faints it can no longer be used, and that I can only catch the first valid encounter per route, I'm also not allowing myself to use any healing items in battle, have to play on set mode, and cannot overlevel the next gym leader's ace before the start of the battle. Oh, and if I ever black out, I have to restart the entire run. Great, with the rules out of the way, it is time to select a Pokemon game. Naturally, my choice fell on Pokemon Platinum. It is home to everyone's favorite Pokemommy, Cynthia, and is one of the hardest games to Nuzlocke, the perfect opportunity to see how well our spicy Pokemon could perform. As for the usable Pokemon, instead of going for any particular YouTuber's secret desires, I approach this more scientifically. If you're familiar with the internet, you have probably heard of Rule 34. It basically states that if something exists, well, there's, let's say, not safe for work content for it. And we're better to look for the hottest Pokemon than there. So for science, I dug deep into the unholy depths and came back scarred for life, but with this list of the 16 spiciest Pokemon. Some of the things I've seen down there can never be unseen. Like, why Piplup? It's literally a baby penguin. Anyway, before we start, please consider to like and subscribe if you enjoy this kind of challenge. Also, let me know which Pokemon you think should be on the list. Personally, I think Milotic should have definitely been part of it, since it's the most beautiful Pokemon according to lore. So, let's get started. As always, my spicy journey starts off with picking one out of three starters. Since Piplup is the only valid one, I didn't really have a choice there. I named him Azure, and after what must have been an eternity of growling and pounding, my rival's Turtwig finally goes down, winning me the first battle of the run. Good start. After receiving some Pokeballs, it was time for my first encounter. Jinx has a 50% chance of having the Intimidate ability here, which is one of the, if not the best ability for Nuzlocke, so I really needed one. Lucky for me, I got a perfect one on my first try, so I didn't have to risk another encounter later on. His name was Blue. By the way, I'm playing with Species Claws, meaning that I can only have one Pokemon for each evolutionary line. I made my way to Jubilife Village. City, it's a city now. Where I caught Badu and named her Viridian. After quickly scrubbing the floor with my rival once more, it was time to head to Orbert City. I caught Grady Onyx in the mines and Crimson the Ponyta on Route 207. The only thing left to do was to run around furiously for about an hour to make Viridian happy enough to evolve into Roselia, which she finally did. Great, it was time for the first gym. Before I get started, in case you were wondering about the number of attempts, in my first few tries, I would only allow myself to use Pokemon that are actually on the list, so no Shinx before it evolved into a Luxray. Since Kranidos almost always outspeeds Piplup, kills Ponyta in like one hit, and Onyx for some reason has a catch rate of negative 100, Rourke felt like an RNG battle for most of the attempts. So I changed the rules to be able to use all Pokemon up to the evolution on the list, meaning Piplup can still never evolve, which was my first reset by the way, but that I can use all the Pokemon I obtained so far. This doesn't really make the challenge easier, all it does is make the first gym more bearable. Anyway, now that that's out of the way, it's time to earn my first badge. Viridian comes out first as Rourke sends in Geodude, which I immediately paralyze with Stun Spore. Then Geodude goes for a Stealth Rock and lets me freely set up with Growth. After a lucky para, my little Rose keeps growing twice more, tanking one Rock Throw in the process. With this setup complete, all Viridian had to do was to suck out the life of my opponent's Rock Collection, winning me an easy first badge. Now, it was time to make my way to Floroma Town. This is also where I got my next encounter, Buizel. I named the little otter Lady Caramel, and after obtaining the entry key to the Valley Windworks, Blue evolved into Luxio. Next up was Mars. This fight is notorious for ending Nuzlocke. She only has two Pokemon, but her ace Perugly is not only fast, but also extremely strong for this early in the game. Fortunately, I already prepared a strategy to beat this battle. Mars leads the fight with her Zubat, and while Blue would have super effective damage, I needed him to wait just a little longer for my plan to work out. Two quick Ember from my hot steed brought Zubat down to what must have been like 1 HP, and the third one sealed the deal. So far, so good. Next up was Perugly. This chunky cat will always go for Fake Out first. I can use this to my advantage and get off a free Intimidate while taking relatively low damage in return. I switched into Gray since Mars doesn't really have a way to hit him. He shrugs off a soft scratch and after reliably tanking another weak feint attack, retaliates with a critical hit Rock Tomb, lowering Perugly's speed. My initial plan was to switch back into Blue, but since Gray was in such a good position here, I decided to stay in and boost my defenses with Harden. After some back and forth, Perugly finally goes down and Mars was defeated. Good job, Gray. So many people fail to see your true potential as a scratching tree for a cat. I was pretty close to the second gym. First though, I had to safely guide Cheryl through the Interna Forest. I initially planned on using a Repel to skip wild encounters, but got distracted and ran straight into the grass patch. And of course, there is a Baneary, because why wouldn't it? All I have seen Cheryl's Chansey do in the past was to kill the one Pokemon I wanted to catch. For some reason, she always knew. Always. Since this was the only place to get Baneary, I had to try anyway. One Flamiel was enough to one-shot the bystanding Ghastly, and then Chansey decided to do what it does best and land a critical hit Egg Bomb. This legend of a bunny holds on with a sliver of health, allowing me to catch it on the next turn. Suck it, Chansey, not this time. I named what has to be the most smashable Pokemon we can get, Hazel, and dropped Cheryl off at the end of the forest, never to speak to her again. I somehow safely made it to Eterna City without missing a single encounter or losing a Pokemon. While preparing for the second gym, I furiously ran around town to get Hazel to like us enough for him to wear fluffy handcuffs, which he eventually did. After that, there was nothing left but the second gym, and for Crimson to do what she does best, burn down weeds. Gardenia's Turtwig was out first. An Ember did a decent chunk of damage, but wasn't enough to take it down completely, which allowed Gardenia to set up Reflect. I had the choice between stalling or attacking, but I didn't want Crimson to take too much damage this early in the battle, so another Ember was enough to finish the Turtwig. Next up was Charon. Two Ember were enough to take it out, as it luckily only went for a Safeguard, giving us a free turn. Last was Roserade. With Reflect still up, I had little choice but to go for an Ember again, even though Roserade has pretty high special defense. She goes for a Stun Spore to paralyze Crimson, but RNG was on my side this time, and Crimson didn't get a full para. After hitting a strong Ember and easily taking a Magical Leaf, the Reflect wore off, and a final Flame Wheel was enough to seal the deal. Nice, two gyms down. While I was busy redesigning Gardenia's workplace, Team Galactic kidnapped another civilian, and since no authority was going to intervene, I had to take over and save the day once again. I made my way to... Oh, who is this? When did it get hot in here? This next battle against Commander Bigger Planet Name goes to show how important it is to properly prepare for a battle in challenges like this. While Jupiter's team isn't nearly as scary as the one Mars has, it can be really unforgiving if her Skunk Tank manages to get into a good position, so I had to be careful. As a quick heads up, when planning for this battle I accidentally looked at Mars's team sheet and so completely missed the Giga Drain on her Zubat, which made this much harder than it had to be. I lead the battle with Gray as Jupiter sends in her Zubat. Right off the bat, Zubat almost one-shots with a 4x super effective Giga Drain, while Gray sets up with Harden. There was no way a Rock Tomb would kill, so I had to switch into Crimson. After easily tanking a Giga Drain, Crimson managed to burn the bat with Ember and tank another Wing Attack. A final Ember was enough to finish Jupiter's first Pokemon. It was time for her ace. Similar to Perugly, this thing hits way too hard in early game, and between Screech, Poison Gas, and Smokescreen has enough tools to wipe my entire team. Gray would be a really good help here, but his health was way too low to switch in. Instead of switching, I went for an Ember instead, to not give Perugly too much free damage. Then her Night Slash took a massive chunk out of Crimson's health. A crit would have been more than enough to kill here. Then I switched into blue to get off an Intimidate, but a critical hit could easily kill from this range. I had to choose a Pokemon to sacrifice to save the run. The early game was the only time for Azir to shine. Since he was going to be off the team soon anyway, I sent him in and he goes down without dealing any damage. After intimidating once more with blue and accidentally switching into Viridian, it was time for Hazel to take this battle home. He tanks a -3 Night Slash, and I returned it a good amount of damage activating Skunk Tank's Citrus Berry. After poisoning my Lopunny, another return was enough to bring Skunk Tank down to low health, as it goes for a Smokescreen, lowering my accuracy. One final return would be enough to finish the battle, but Hazel was out of luck and missed two in a row, causing her to go down to Night Slash and poison damage. If my calculations are correct, the odds of missing return twice here are 1%. Something rabbit's foot, huh? I brought in blue, lowering Skunk Tank's attack for the fourth time. In order to avoid another Smokescreen, I went for a Spark, which never misses as blue dodges a 1-in-8 crit and managed to finish the battle. Had I led this battle with Crimson, I would have probably won it without any deaths. At least I learned my lesson to always check the documentation twice. The next part of the game doesn't really have a lot of plot, so I'll mostly skip over it. With only 5 Pokemon left, it was time to refill my team with new encounters. But I accidentally killed Gible in Wayward Cave with the Leech Seed, so the mighty Landshark will have to wait until we reach Victory Road. I caught Mint the Ralts before Hearthhome City and evolved her straight away. I also picked up the free Eevee from the girl next to the Pokemon Center, and since I saw so many Eeveelutions on R34, I had the option to pick anyone except Leafeon. I already had a much stronger option for most of the evolution types, and since my team was missing some bulk, I named the little guy Obsidian and evolved him into an Umbreon. So let's see how my new team can fare against Fantina. The only way for her Duskull to properly hit Viridian was with a 2-turn Future Sight, and so I used that to my advantage and set up a Leech Seed on my first turn, as she only hits a Will-O-Wisp, burning my plant. Then I switch into Caramel, as Duskull goes for the predicted Future Sight. Since that wasn't going to hit for another turn, it was safe for me to go for a Crunch and take out Fantina's first Pokemon. She sends in her Miss Mages next, as I switch into Obsidian, tanking a soft Magical Leaf and a delayed Future Sight damage. I didn't really have a way to hit Miss Mages here, so I brought in Blue, who immediately gets confused on the switch-in. A Shadow Ball did way too much damage as Blue broke through confusion, hitting a decent bite. I wasn't going to risk one of my strongest Pokemon here, so I went into Gray. In hindsight, that wasn't the best idea, since Onix has an abysmal special defense, as a Shadow Ball almost instantly obliterates him. He is respectably consistent in surviving with less than 10 HP every time though. In a hope to save as many Pokemon as I could, I went into Crimson, and even though she managed to proc Miss Major's Citrus Berry, took way too much damage, and so another sack was in order. Gray also wasn't going to be a really big help from here on out, and so I switched him in one last time. Caramel came out next, only for me to realize that I actually outspeed and one-shot with a Crunch. Fantina sent in her Haunter next, but a Sucker Punch was almost no damage, and so another Crunch was enough to win me badge number 3. I started losing some of my weaker Pokemon, but other than that, everything was going well so far. As I'm about to leave the city, my rival ambushed me for another battle. But at this point, his team is still no match for mine. Aside from Blue almost falling to a cheeky Endeavor plus Pursuit strategy from his Staravia and Buizel, I take him out without any other issues. Route 209 was where I had initially planned to catch a Vulpix, only to now realize that it wasn't even in the game. I skipped the encounter for now, but ended up finding a replacement for it later on, which actually happened to carry almost the entire run. Can you guess what it is? Though I'm getting ahead of myself. Since the challenge was about hot Pokemon, I had the idea of breeding a Vaporeon here, but Obsidian was male and so I just moved on to the next gym. On my way there, I caught a Meryl on Route 212 and named her Sapphire. She also had the Thick Fat ability, which could help for all of the Ice-type Pokemon in the upcoming sections of the game. With the new level cap of 32, I was able to evolve Mint and Blue right before the next gym battle. It was time for Meilene, and the strategy I came up with to beat her was way too overkill. Listen, I just didn't want to lose the battle here. First up was her Meditite. Aside from having the Pure Power ability, which lets it hit super hard by increasing its attack stat, it wasn't really that big of a threat. I start the battle off with Blue to immediately lower its attack. Then I switched into Crimson to absorb the incoming Fake Out. From there, it was back to Blue again for another attack drop. There was a chance Meditite could go for a Rock Tomb next, so I switched into Caramel, and I think you can see where this is going. After bringing Meditite to -6, I switched into Obsidian to force her into using anything else but Confusion, since the AI usually won't choose a move that can't hit my current Pokemon. From there, I safely switch into Viridian to tank a Rock Tomb and set up a Leech Seed before getting hit by a soft Confusion. I could now switch into Mint and freely set up with Calm Mind, while Leech Seed healed almost all of Meditite's damage back. The combination of 5 Calm Minds and a Mind Plate was enough to sweep through Meilene's entire team without a problem. Mint had to take a stat boost at Metal Claw from Lucario, but not even a crit could have killed there. Sometimes setup strats are just way too good at abusing weak elite Pokemon like that. From there, it was straight to the Pastoria Gym to defeat Crusher Wake. Mint wasn't going to be a great help here, so I switched her out for Sapphire, which could at least tank some Ice Fangs from Floatzel. I lead the battle with Blue into Wake's Gyarados. He went for a Waterfall, but I immediately take out the Pool Noodle with a 4x effective Thunder Fang. Next was Quagsire, but Blue couldn't really damage it, and so I switched into my own Floatzel. I barely did any damage while slowly going down to repeated mud shots, so I switched into Sapphire as Quagsire went for a Yawn. Instead of switching out and giving him free damage, I set up an Aqua Ring and let my balloon fall asleep. Unfortunately, I didn't get the turn 1 wake up as Quagsire confuses Sapphire with a Water Pulse. Great, now I'm asleep and confused. After sleeping for the max amount of turns, Sapphire finally wakes up, only to hit herself in confusion. On the positive side, during all of this, Aqua Ring was enough to keep my health bar fairly full. After tanking another Water Pulse, Sapphire managed to finally hit a Bubble Beam, which barely missed out on a kill. There was a chance Wake was going to heal on the next turn, and so it was pretty safe for me to bring in Viridian. One Giga Drain was enough to remove the creepy smile from Quagsire's face. Last was Floatzel, which had Ice Fang, so I planned on switching into Sapphire to absorb the hit. I wanted to set up another set of Aqua Rings, but unfortunately, a Crunch did way more damage than I expected. I didn't want to risk the run with the wrong switch here, and so I decided to go for a Tail Whip and lower Floatzel's defenses instead. After that, I switched into Obsidian to tank an incoming Crunch, and to lower Floatzel's attack with Growl. But he went for an Ice Fang and got the freeze. Predicting another Ice Fang, I went for the pivot switch through Crimson into Blue, who lowered my opponent's attack and tanked a weak Aqua Jet. Since I didn't outspeed, Blue had to dodge all the potential flinches and freezes on Floatz's next attack. Lucky for me, he only went for a Brine as my Thunder Fang connects and one-shots. Some unlucky rolls made this harder than it had to be, but in the end, my team and I managed to get out unscathed. Next, Cynthia wanted me to meet her parents, and so I made my way to Celestic Town, successfully killing my Pichu encounter in Trophy Garden on the way. After fighting my way through what has to be the worst weather condition Nintendo has ever come up with, I eventually get there and was ready to take on Cyrus for the first time. I never really understood why we even fight here. I'm literally just talking to an old lady about a painting on the wall, and he just starts accusing her for no reason, and she's all like, "I don't know, man, I just got here." But hey, I'm trying to convince Cynthia's mom to let me be with her, so sure, let me play the hero. Cyrus leads the battle with his Sneasel as I sent in Caramel. I am pretty sure I Rock Smash with one shot, so I have no idea why I clicked Aqua Jet instead. After a Screech, I went for another Aqua Jet, only to take massive damage from a Slash. I don't really know what I was thinking here. Another Slash would surely one shot, so I switched into Crimson to tank the hit fairly well. Then Sneasel went for another Slash as Crimson goes for an Ember, which barely missed out on a kill, but a lucky burn was enough to take Sneasel out. Next was Golbat, and I somehow decided to switch into Sapphire over Blue. Listen, I have no idea what's going on here, but we're both going down this road together now, okay? Golbat barely dealt any damage with Poison Fang and confused Sapphire with a Supersonic as she tries to go for a rollout only to flop over and hit herself. The amount of times Sapphire hits herself in this run is starting to get me a little worried. On the next turn, she tried to redeem herself, tanking an Air Cutter and landing a critical hit rollout. Then she tanks a second Air Cutter as she hits herself in confusion once again, just for good measure. She was now way too low to stay in, so I finally switched into Blue and finished Cyrus' Golbat and Murkrow with a Shockwave each. I don't know why I didn't do this sooner. Cyrus disappears in thin air as the old lady hands me Surf, which I take as her approval for my relationship with Cynthia. This looks like a ring after all, I guess. I don't really know why I went for the marrying Cynthia narrative, but here we are, so we're just gonna continue with that. I eventually made it to Canalave City for what probably is my first real rival battle. Though fighting on a drawbridge might not seem like the best idea. Staraptor was out first, so I lead into it with Blue. I'm pretty sure he's always programmed to go for a double team here, so as to not miss a move, I went for a Shockwave, securing me the first kill. Rapidash was out next, so I switched into Sapphire. After tanking two takedowns, she sets up an Aqua Ring to heal back some of the damage. Then Rapidash misses a third takedown as Bubble brings him down to low HP. From there, tanking one last takedown and a follow-up Bubble Beam was enough to finish the job. Next up was Torterra, but since it had no ground type moves, I switched into Viridian, who tanks the incoming Razor Leaf, as a Grass Knot dealt more than half of the turtle's health. After that, it retaliates with a concerning amount of damage from a bite, but since we outspeed, another Grass Knot easily took out my rival starter. Viridian had no way of killing the following Heracross, and since I didn't really have a good switch, I went for Crimson. She tanked an Air Lace, but since I wasn't allowed to evolve her, her lack in damage started to show. Ember barely did anything as a Brick Break brings her down to 7 HP. I switched back into Blue to lower Heracross's damage as it went for a Night Slash. Another Brick Break did barely any damage as Blue landed a critical hit bite. Another Brick Break brings Blue down to low health as I went for another bite, which didn't do nearly enough damage given Heracross resists the move, which I only now realized. Should have read the messages on the screen. I knew another Brick Break wouldn't kill, so I risked the crit and finally decided to go for a Thunder Fang, killing Heracross and leveling up in the process. With 18 HP left, it was time for my rival's final Pokemon. Remember when I mentioned Weasel's pursuit almost killing Luxray in my rival battle right after the third gym? Yeah, this is where I realized what mistake I just made. Blue wasn't going to outspeed a Floatzel for a kill, and switching was impossible because Pursuit hits me no matter what. I had already admitted defeat as my stupid rival goes for an Aqua Jet instead, which left Blue with 2 HP. The level up I just got gave me literally 2 HP. It's the only reason why Blue survived this. And not only did he survive, he also connects and one-shots with a Thunder Fang right after. I was so upset misplaying this battle this much, but Blue did what he does best and brought it back home. I don't know how I keep getting away with some of the bad plays that I'm making, but I'm on attempt 7 now, so I'll take those stupid AI moments. With the rival defeated, I now get access to the Iron Islands, where I help Riley clear out some galaxy grunts, and as a thank you, he gives me an egg. While battling through the caves, I accidentally fired an avoidable double battle, where I was forced to sacrifice Sapphire in a 2v1 against a Calm Mind boosted Cirilia and a Staravia. But I also picked up a Shiny Stone to evolve for Zelia and finally get my own Roserade. For the third time in this run, I spent what must have been an entire day running around Canalave for Riolu to hatch and to like me enough to evolve into Indigo the Lucario. With that, I had a solid team for the 6th gym. On a side note, I was today years old when I realized that Byron was Rourke's dad. While fighting my way to the gym leader, I met Ace Trainer Caesar, and oh boy do I hate Caesar. He only had a scissor, and that's pretty easy to deal with a fire type, right? There's this one YouTuber that always mentions to always, always play around your critical hits. But can someone tell me how to prevent this? With Crimson down, my death started to rack up. I brought Blue back onto the team as he was the last boxed Pokemon, and it was time to take on Byron. With only 6 Pokemon left, I had to come up with an insane strategy to beat this gym. No, just kidding, it's Byron. I lead the battle with Lucario and went for a Swords Dance, turn 1, since Magneton couldn't really touch him. Just to be sure, I also gave Lucario Cherry Berry to avoid getting paralyzed from Thunderbolt. From there, 3 stat boosted Drain Punch were enough to win me an easy 6th batch, like father like son. The Galaxy team blew up some lakes to free the legendary Pokemon inside, but the battles weren't really that interesting, so I'll just fast forward to the next important part of the story. Gym 7. The only noticeable encounter on my way there was Navy the Sneasel, who was very important for the next fight. After eventually clearing the puzzle that is way harder than I remember from Brilliant Diamond Shining Pearl, I approached Shi, who cannot be named, and to be honest, I was kind of scared of this battle. Her Snowcloak Double Team Frostlass is definitely nothing to be trifled with. First up though was Sneasel. Indigo immediately went for a Swords Dance and shrugs off a soft Aerial Ace. Then I went for another Swords Dance as another Aerial Ace leaves me slightly above half health. From there, one Drain Punch was enough to one-shot the Sneasel and heal Indigo back to full. Since I outspeed Piloswine, a plus 4 Drain Punch was enough to kill the Fluffy Piggy. Abomasnow was next, setting up Hail for Frostlass and, you guessed it, goes down to yet another Drain Punch. Finally, Candace sends out her ace. The hail made it so that hitting a move would become really difficult, and with double team, she could boost her evasion even more. I'm pretty sure Candace is programmed to double team turn 1, but regardless of that, none of her attacks couldn't even remotely kill Navy. So I sent her in as Frostlass went for the anticipated double team. Then Navy went for a never missing feint attack, which barely missed out on the kill. A Citrus Berry brought Frostlass out of healing range as she went for another double team. For some reason, does Candace know I can literally never miss her? She even came in to tell me she's not about to lose. Well, I immediately prove her wrong as another feint attack shreds her Frostlass kimono, leaving her with no other choice but to give me the 7th batch. With that out of the way, I went straight to the Acuity Lakefront to catch my very own Frostlass, who I named Red. Like it is custom in many Pokemon games, it was now time for me to save the world from a criminal organization. I cleared out the Galaxy Headquarter in Veilstone City and defeated Cyrus a second time. This battle is just a slightly easier version of the upcoming final battle against him, so I'll just skip ahead. There's one thing though, Navy died to a critical Drill Peck against the Galactic Leader's Honchkrow, but she wasn't allowed to evolve, so this wasn't too big of a loss. I made my way to Mount Coronet, where the Galaxy Leader was trying to summon the gods of space and time to destroy the entire world because he didn't like the way it was. But before being able to stop him, I had to fight both Mars and Jupiter in a double battle together with my rival. This can always be a bit tricky since he is, as the saying goes, not the sharpest bulb in the shed or something. So let's see how this one went. The battle starts off with 2 Bronzor. I lead with Caramel and my rival throws in his Munchlax. I went for a Surf, which Munchlax tanks pretty easily, but crits one of the Bronzors and does decent damage to the other. Then Munchlax went for a Stockpile and both Bronzors set up Light Screen and Reflect respectively. I surfed once more, which was enough to kill one of the Bronzors, but did barely any damage to the remaining one, which then immediately retaliates with an extra sensory on Caramel. Munchlax just heals itself with a Swallow, doing nothing for a second turn in a row. Jupiter sends out her Skunk Tank next, as I switch into Lucario, absorbing a Poison Jab, and only taking minimal damage from another extra sensory. Munchlax stockpiles again, still dealing no damage. At this point, I was really exhausted from playing the game, and so I went for a Combo Breaker of bad decisions. Watch this. First, I went for an Earthquake, dealing barely any damage to my opponent due to Levitate and Reflect. Munchlax, however, took enough damage to die to a falling Poison Jab from a Skunk Tank. Ready for bad decision number 2? I didn't think Lucario would outspeed a freaking Rapidash, and so I went for an Earthquake, hoping to do enough damage for one of my opponents to die after my rival's attack. But what really happened is that Indigo outsped, didn't kill any of my opponents, but one-shot my rival's horse and then immediately died to a flamethrower and extra sensory combo. Maybe spread moves under double screens wasn't the way to go here. I had to play much more careful now, and so I brought in blue. The next turn, my rival finally decides to contribute to the battle, killing the remaining Bronzor as a Thunderfang barely missed out on the kill and skunk tank. Next up was Mars Perugly, which is something I wanted to desperately avoid. Having both these monsters on the field at the same time can be extremely scary. Lucky for me, Staraptor sees a kill with a quick attack before going down to a slash from Perugly. Then blue hits a strong Thunderfang, activating the cat's citrus berry. My rival's Heracross then absorbed a fast Aerolace from a Golbat, before that one dies to blue's Thunderfang. Then Heracross went for a close combat, sealing the deal on Mars Perugly. The final Golbat goes down to another one of blue's Thunderfangs, winning me the most chaotic battle so far. There really was no reason for me to lose Indigo here. This was actually really bad, since Lucario was my only plan to safely beat Cyrus in the upcoming battle. With his two commanders defeated, he then summoned not only one, but three legendary Pokemon, one of which directly drags him into the Shadow Realm. I quickly replaced Indigo with Viridian, as Cynthia showed up, and after clearing the Distortion World, our last battle to save the world was waiting. This next fight was going to be extremely difficult, and I tried to approach it from like 10 different angles. Every possible outcome was based on pure luck of either hitting a certain move or dodging crits. Indigo would have made this so much easier. It took me a while, but eventually I came up with a strategy that might get me through this with minimal sacrifices. Buckle up, this is going to be a wild ride. First up was Houndoom. I lead Caramel into it, even though it has Thunderfang, but there was really no other way of killing it without taking too much damage. There was a 3% chance that Surf didn't kill here, but Caramel came in clutch and took out the pup without a problem. Next up was Gyarados. This was going to be the single hardest Pokemon to take out. I needed to find a safe way to switch into blue to finish off the rest of Cyrus's team. A direct switch was too risky, since the AI has a small chance of just going for an earthquake, ending the run right there. Any other team member was also at too much risk of taking too much damage from Gyarados' strong attacks. I had to make a choice, and so I switched into red, predicting a Giga Impact, as that was Cyrus's strongest move into Caramel. Good thing I didn't switch into blue, as Gyarados went for an earthquake. There was no way Red could stay in like this, and yet again, switching was a gamble since the AI probably sees a kill with all four moves. Obsidian was my safest option, and so I brought him in as he brushed off an incoming waterfall. The reason why I needed Obsidian to stay healthy was because it was the only way to safely take out Crobat, but I had to finish this pool noodle first to ever get there. The next turn, I went for a Toxic, only for Gyarados to flinch me with a waterfall. Then Gyarados went for a third waterfall as I tried my luck on another Toxic, which finally connected. Next, I went for a Protect to build up some poison damage. I had to switch out again, and so I went into Viridian, predicting another waterfall, which was correct, but did way too much damage for the fact that Viridian resists the move. After stalling another turn with Protect, it was time for Caramel to come out and tank the incoming Ice Fang, since that was Gyarados' only super effective move. But the AI decided to completely throw types out of the window and went for an Earthquake yet again, dealing massive damage. Gyarados was now in healing range, and so I had a window to freely switch into blue, as the Galactic Leader went for the predicted full restore. Then a 4x super effective Shockwave was enough to finally remove Gyarados from the field. Or not. When calculating the damage, I completely forgot that Pokemon had natures too. Cyrus then punished my hubris with an Earthquake, which thankfully only took close to half of my health. The next turn I went for a last Shockwave, removing the second Pokemon from the field. My team was in a tough spot now, since most of them already took quite some damage. Next up was Cyrus Ace Weavile. It always goes for a fake out, so I switched into red to absorb the attack. There was no safe switch from there, and so I went for an Ice Shard, knowing Frostlass would fall to the incoming Night Slash. This gave me a free switch into Caramel, who managed to outspeed and retaliate with a hard-hitting Rock Smash that also activated Weavile's Citrus Berry. The incoming Night Slash luckily didn't crit, as Caramel finished the Ace with another Rock Smash and 21 HP left on the board. With Caramel this low, there was a 1 in 4 chance for me to make the right choice here, since the AI chooses a random move if it sees the kill with all of them. I switched into Obsidian, which immediately paid off as Honchko actually goes for a Psychic, which is the one move that can't hit him. Then I switched into Blue to get off an Intimidate and tank a soft Drill Pack. From there, one Thunderfang was enough to finish the job. Last was Crobat, which outspeeds every single remaining Pokemon of my team. With not many choices left, I decided to stay in as Crobat missed the crit on Cross Poison and barely lived a Thunderfang. In order to save Luxray from sure death, I switched back into Obsidian, only for me to realize that Cyrus had another full restore. In an attempt to save however much I could, I went for a Confuse Ray, hoping for some lucky turns. I Protect, as Crobat does just that and hits itself in Confusion the next turn. Then I went for another Sucker Punch, as Crobat hits itself again. With enough luck, it would hit itself enough for us to win this battle. After another Sucker Punch, Crobat snaps out of Confusion and retaliates with a soft cross poison, hitting the 10% rolled poisoning Obsidian. That was it for our little guy. He was doing his best to save my team from my mistakes, but the poison was just enough to end his journey. He did way more than I expected to bring this team through this fight though. I owed it to him to finish the battle, and so an Aqua Jet from Caramel sealed the deal on what must have been the hardest battle yet. Cyrus's plan on World Domination crushed, Blue quickly swiped the floor with the God of the Shadow Realm in a Yu-Gi-Oh! Battle over life and death. Remember the Vulpix I didn't get earlier? It's time to present you the MVP of the Sunny Shore City Gym. But I couldn't just pick any random Pokemon I wanted. Science required me to go back onto the Unholy Land and search for another valid Pokemon from Rule 34. And here's Ivory the Absol. This beast had Super Luck, which increased its chance of landing a critical hit. Together with Razor Claw and the increased crit ratio from Slash, this killing machine can crit every 1 in 3 moves. But before being able to demonstrate Ivory's destructive power, I had to first convince the gym leader to do his job. He was so upset that nobody was good enough to beat him that he just didn't want to fight anymore. After promising him the best battle of his life, I did just that, and here's your Maylene flashback. Volkno leads the battle with Jolteon, which only knows Charge Beam, Thunder Wave, Iron Tail, and Quick Attack. Nothing that can really damage Ivory, but to be able to safely set up, I needed to lower its attack. So I started the battle with Blue and immediately switched into Viridian, who tanked a really soft Charge Beam. Then she set up Leech Seed as Jolteon went for a Thunder Wave, which immediately got cured by a Cherry Berry. With heals in place, it was time to switch into Blue once again to lower Jolteon's attack to -2. From there, I switched into Mint as she shrugs off a soft Quick Attack. Then I set up both Light Screen and Reflect as Jolteon's damage gets completely negated by my setup. I then switched into Ivory and maxed out his attack with Sword Stance, while Leech Seed brought Jolteon low enough for Volkno to waste a heal. Then I missed a Sucker Punch as Jolteon connects with a Thunder Wave, but I came prepared as my Cherry Berry healed the status effect once again. From there, 4 attacks were enough to one-shot every single one of the 8th Gym Leader's Pokemon, winning me an easy final batch. Hope this was the battle you were looking for, Volkner. With every gym completed, I eventually made my way through Victory Road, picking up my last team member Zomp, the Garchomp, on the way. That is actually a real color, so shout out to one of my Twitch viewers Starling to find that one. Also, can someone tell me what Clint is up to? Why is the entire Victory Road filled with Ace Trainers and fully evolved teams, and this man just sits there with his Gible? Anyway, with that the final stretch of the run was in reach, but before being able to enter the Elite Four Gauntlet, I had to beat my rival for one last time. He leads the battle with Staraptor as I bring in Zomp to force him into U-turn into Floatzel, as it was the only Pokemon with an Ice-type move. He does just that as I freely set up Stealth Rocks. You should be pretty familiar with what comes next, so here's a short version for it. I lower Floatzel's attack by continuously switching between Blue and Caramel, taking relatively low damage in the process. Then I switch into Ivory, setting up 3 Sword Stance, dodging Brick Break crits every single time. From there, you guessed it, all 6 of my rival Pokemon just dropped like flies. I told you Ivory would carry the run. Somehow my team and I made it all the way to the end. All that was left to do to beat Platinum with hot Pokemon only was to take out the Elite Four and the hardest champion in the entire series. Let's do this. First was Aaron and his Bug-type Pokemon. Yanmega was out first, and since it was very likely to go for a double team on turn 1, I went for a Dragon Claw, bringing it down to heal range. Then Aaron goes for a full restore as I hit an Aerial Ace. After going for a U-turn, the Bug Catcher brings out his ace Drapion to absorb my next hit. I outspeed, and a stat boosted Dig was enough to one-shot it. Next was Heracross, but a 4x effective Aerial Ace just takes it out. Then Aaron sent in his Wespequeen, who managed to tank another attack and retaliates with a soft attack order. 2 more air relays were enough to kill Vespiquen and the following Yanmega. Last was Aaron's Scissor, but it was no match for Zom's mighty Fire Fang. Next up was the Rock-type Elite Four Bertha. She leads with Wish Cash, so I bring in Viridian to one-shot with a Giga Drain. This brings out Gliscor next as I switch into Caramel, who gets hit by a strong Earthquake. But since I outspeed all of Bertha's Pokemon, 3 Surf got me directly to her ace Hippowdon. It has the Sandstream ability, which sets up a Sandstorm, boosting its special defense, and so I wasn't sure if another Surf would kill it. I switched into Zomp as he could easily absorb the incoming Earthquake. Then I went for a Dragon Claw, bringing Hippowdon to half health. After surviving another Earthquake with 69 HP,
nice,
one final Dragon Claw earned me the win over Bertha. Flint was out next, but his fire types stood no chance against Caramel. Houndoom, Infernape, and Rapidash all went down to a single Surf without touching her at all. McMortar managed to survive a hit and heal itself with a Citrus Berry, but only went for Solar Beam, which takes two turns to hit without the Sun. Since outspeed, another Surf killed McMortar and the final Flareon. The last of the Elite Four was Lucian. He's running a Psychic-type team, and you know what shreds through Psychic-type Pokémon? Ivory. Lucian leads with Mr. Mime, and it can't really hit Ivory with anything else but Thunderbolt. I set up with Swords Dance as I waited for Mr. Mime's Reflect to run out. From there, a few Sucker Punch and Night Slashes were enough to eliminate Lucian's entire team, bringing us to the final battle of the run. How poetic to end the run by defeating our true soulmate. She's the hardest champion of any Pokemon game. The plan for this battle was simple. Abuse her weakest Link Spiritomb to set up Ivory to let her do what she has been doing quite well so far. But Spiritomb knows Civil Wind, which could do a ton of damage to my Dark-type carry. So I went for the greediest play in the entire run as I lead the battle with Mint to set up Light Screen. This halves the damage of incoming special moves, and so the following Shadow Ball did barely any damage to her. After that, I tried my luck with a 70% accurate Hypnosis, which connects putting Spiritomb asleep. From there, I send in Viridian to set up Leech Seed as Spiritomb keeps napping on the battlefield. I send in Ivory as Cynthia's Pokemon wakes up and goes for a Psychic, which doesn't affect him. I now went for a Swords Dance as Silverwind does barely any damage. After tanking two more Silverwind, a final Swords Dance maxed out Ivory's attack and it was time for the sweep. Spiritomb goes down to a Night Slash and then came out Lucario. See, now this could be the end of the run already, but instead of going for a planned Psycho Cut, I went for a Sucker Punch, which Lucario resists 4 times. Obviously that wasn't going to one-shot, and so my entire plan crumbled as Lucario went for an Aura Sphere, killing Ivory in the process. I was in trouble. I brought in Zomp, and luckily Lucario was low enough to finish it with a single dig. Next up was Cynthia's own Garchomp. Landshark versus Landshark. Knowing I was faster, I went for a Dragon Claw and barely missed out on the kill. This also activated the Citrus Berry, healing Cynthia's Garchomp back to a quarter of its health. Then Zomp managed to tank a brutal Dragon Rush and took out Cynthia's Ace with another Dragon Claw. Milotic was out next, so I immediately switched into Blue, who got hit by a soft Dragon Pulse. Then he hits a Thunderfang as a Surf leaves both of our Pokemon on low health. Cynthia now went for a full Restore as a Thunderfang brings it right back to the red. Then Blue missed his first Thunderfang in the entire playthrough and goes down to a Surf. I actually could have gone for a Shockwave here, which never misses, but oh well. This was bad because now I had no surefire way of dealing with Cynthia's Togekiss. I sent in Caramel and went for a Surf, leaving Milotic on 1 HP as she retaliates with a Dragon Pulse. Since she doesn't use any full restores, she must be out of healing items, and so a final Surf brings down the Water Serpent. This brings out Roserade. It's the final battle of the run, so losing a Pokemon wasn't going to change the outcome as long as one manages to survive. So I went for an Ice Fang, hoping it would just one-shot. But Cynthia's luck doesn't seem to end as her Pokemon survives on 5% HP yet again and one-shots Caramel with a Sludge Bomb. I sent in Mint next as Cynthia somehow pulls out another full restore, but it didn't really change anything as Roserade goes down to a Psychic. The champion now sends in her final Pokemon. I set up Light Screen since Togekiss only has special moves, as an Air Slash barely does any damage. The next turn, I went for Hypnosis to secure me the victory. It actually connects, and from there, two Psychic brought Togekiss down to low health, as it eventually wakes up and hits another soft Air Slash. And with a final Psychic, Cynthia was defeated, making me the Sinnoh champion with only hot Pokemon. And with that, I somehow managed to beat a hardcore Nuzlocke of Pokemon Platinum, only using hot Pokemon. Let me know in the comments down below which run you want me to do next, and remember to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this challenge. Thank you for watching.